At 9:55 a.m. the morning of October 15, 1962, a delivery was quietly received at the unimposing Stewart Building in Washington, D.C. The nondescript site housed the top-secret National Photographic Interpretation Center, or NPIC, home to the intelligence discipline of photo interpretation. However, the delivery of film from a recent U-2 flight over Cuba proved to be anything but insignificant. On its receipt, four NPIC photo interpreters immediately set to work analyzing the images, and within hours, their tradecraft would lead to the discovery of Soviet missiles in Cuba, setting in motion the 13-day nuclear standoff that would come to be known as the Cuban Missile Crisis. Prior to that fateful day, intelligence professionals across multiple agencies gathered what would become the groundwork behind the missile discovery. At the Central Intelligence Agency, reports of missiles in Cuba flowed in for months from human intelligence sources, and at the National Security Agency, analysts tracked a recent surge in the ongoing military buildup of the island. Despite these indications, the lack of hard photographic evidence coupled with the belief that Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev would not challenge the existing Cold War balance of power meant no decisive action was taken.
Prior to January 1962, we had already received some 200 reports of missiles in Cuba. Of course, this was before there were any missiles at all. The problem of separating the wheat from the chaff was a problem of trying to correlate events, of cross-checking the references, and of trying to pull up out of an enormous amount of confusing, misleading, sometimes contradictory reporting, what the patterns are upon which you might base a judgment as to the facts extant at the time.
Amid this influx of information, multiple correlating intelligence indications led the Defense Intelligence Agency to request a U-2 mission to collect aerial reconnaissance, which ultimately provided the clear proof of missiles in Cuba. Realizing the significance of their discovery, NPIC interpreters confirmed their findings using an array of materials, including weapons manuals clandestinely obtained from Soviet spy Oleg Penkovsky, and a collection of materials maintained by NPIC's information branch headed by Dino Brugioni. Known as black books, these collateral materials included everything from foreign publications to military parade photos taken by attachés in Moscow.
We assembled all the information we had on the system, and at that point, being convinced we had the SS-4 missile plus the associated equipment, I called Dino and asked for some additional support to make sure that we considered all possibilities. We looked at his specialized files of SS-3, SS-4, SS-5. We checked the various photos, prints, details that he had. After seeing again the parade photos together with the photogrammetric measurements Dino had, I was convinced without a doubt we had the SS-4 system.
With this confirmation and combined with the robust underpinning of multi-intelligence reports, senior decision makers turned their attention to the question of how and when to respond.
General, what about if the Soviet Union announces that if we attack Cuba that it's going to be nuclear war? What's your judgment as to the chances they'll fire these things off if we invade Cuba?
Oh, I don't believe
that. Yeah, they will. In other words, you would take that risk if the situation seems dire.
As a matter of fact, though, what can you do? If this thing is such a serious thing here on our flank that we're going to be uneasy, all right, we got to use something. Right. Something may make these people shoot them off. I just don't believe this will.
Yeah, all right.
Time was of paramount importance, particularly related to the operational status of the missiles. Knowing how quickly they could be launched against the United States would determine how quickly decision makers would need to respond.
The big issue of the moment was whether to send in our Air Force to take out the missile bases and the Army to invade the island. With the aid of the material Penkovsky delivered, we were able to tell the President, quote, "This is what we've got here, and it will take them X days to be ready to fire," unquote. It gave President Kennedy time to maneuver.
The urgent need for around-the-clock intelligence to support the decision-maker was palpable. At NSA, for instance, Radar signals and radio intercepts were providing near real-time updates on efforts in Cuba to complete missile site construction. And with the ability to both discover and verify intelligence, aerial reconnaissance flights were significantly increased. The resulting flood of imagery necessitated a 24/7 crisis response. NPIC instituted 12-hour shifts as interpreters were called on to review 30 to 40 rolls of incoming film per day. A single roll held between 500 to 5,000 feet of film. At DIA, a Cuban Situation Room was established to centrally coordinate efforts. NSA established their first ever around-the-clock command center to manage the increase in signals intelligence collection from radio intercept listening posts. By October 22nd, intelligence sources had discovered additional missile sites and proved that efforts to make these sites operational were increasing rapidly. President Kennedy decided it was time to address the nation.
Good evening, my fellow citizens. This government, as promised, has maintained the closest surveillance of the Soviet military buildup on the island of Cuba. Within the past week, unmistakable evidence has established the fact that a series of offensive missile sites is now in preparation on that imprisoned island. The purpose of these bases can be none other than to provide a nuclear strike capability against the Western Hemisphere.
In his remarks, President Kennedy also announced the first coordinated response of the United States, the establishment of a quarantine in the waters surrounding Cuba.
The United States' answer to what Adlai Stevenson termed Soviet blackmail in Cuba was a quarantine of all offensive weapons being shipped from Russia to that island fortress. The U.S. threw up a steel fence, prepared to stop any vessel carrying materials of war.
Agencies across the intelligence community supported the quarantine effort. At NPIC, photo interpreters analyzed imagery of approaching Soviet ships, identifying those likely carrying weapons. Meanwhile, NSA intercepted and triangulated messages between the ships and the Soviet Union, allowing them to determine the course of incoming vessels. With public acknowledgement of the crisis, a new and equally urgent requirement was created to win the trust and support not only of world leaders, but the press and public. Here too, the intelligence community made significant contributions. This was most evident on October 25th, when U.S. Ambassador Adlai Stevenson, armed with briefing boards and a script prepared by NPIC, gave a presentation to the United Nations Security Council.
Shows three successive photographic enlargements of another missile base of the same type in the area of San Cristobal. These enlarged photographs clearly show six of these missiles on trailers and three erectors. And that is only one example of the first type of ballistic missile installation in Cuba.
Despite such overwhelming evidence, the Soviet Union continued its efforts to make the Cuban missile sites operational. On Saturday, October 27th, known as the longest day, the danger of nuclear war reached its peak. That morning, NPIC Director Art Lundahl briefed President Kennedy that multiple missile sites in Cuba were now operational.
How far advanced is this? Sir, we've never seen this kind of an installation before.
That afternoon, Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara reported that low-altitude aircraft were taking fire from Cuban defenders. A short time later, intercepted broadcasts from Radio Havana indicated a U-2 pilot had been shot down. Within hours, multiple intelligence agencies were able to confirm that Major Rudolph Anderson was shot down near Banas, Cuba. All-out war appeared to be approaching with accelerating and irreversible speed. That night, the United States began final military preparations as Marine brigades boarded ships bound for invasion staging areas. Thousands of Air Force reservists were told to report to their active duty stations, and U.S. destroyers patrolled the Atlantic. At 9:09 a.m., the morning of October 28th, the White House received a teletype message from Foreign Broadcast Information Service. The statement simply read, Moscow Domestic Service in Russian at 1404 Greenwich Mean Time on 28 October broadcast a message from Khrushchev to President Kennedy stating that the USSR had decided to dismantle Soviet missiles in Cuba and return them to the Soviet Union. The crisis had been averted. The intelligence community, however, had one more critical role to play. For months afterward, intelligence professionals from NPIC, NSA, and DIA continued to monitor Cuba, as well as the naval shipment of materials back to the USSR, providing hard evidence that the weapons had been removed. On February 6, 1963, John Hughes, special assistant to the director of DIA, presented a summary of this evidence to the nation. His briefing utilized declassified imagery from throughout the crisis, which assured Americans that the immediate threat was truly over.
In conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, there is little doubt that the Soviet Union did embark upon a bold venture to establish clandestinely a major offensive weapons base in the Western Hemisphere, that the United States was able to deter this effort and is now able to monitor the remaining defensive forces is in large part attributable to the reconnaissance photography that we have reviewed this afternoon. Thank you very much.
Hughes could not make public at the time the great debt owed to the intelligence professionals of multiple agencies whose dedication and skill proved critical to resolving one of the worst crises of the Cold War era and averted nuclear catastrophe. 60 years later, the ability and intention of the intelligence community to provide decision makers with timely, accurate, and comprehensive intelligence remains steadfast and can mean the difference between war and peace.